With the state of the world today, it feels good to be reducing the costs of growing food for us and our environment by replacing chemicals with organic and biological fertilisers and natural pesticides. But have you ever wondered if there was another option? One where we are not constantly running on empty, weeding, mulching, digging, making compost, or relying on expensive equipment and machinery to do the work. Dr. Wendy Seabrook has worked with farmers and gardeners for decades, promoting sustainable agriculture.
Like virtually everyone else, I mistakenly believed that switching to organic and biological inputs was the best that we could do. How else could we stop our leafy greens getting chewed and our fruit riddled with holes, and also replace the nutrients we removed when we harvested our crops? But there is another option, relying on nature's free ecological services by repairing the ecosystems in our veggie gardens, orchards, and fields.
No matter our climate, growing conditions, or location on the planet, by growing food ecologically, we harvest healthy food with soils naturally supplying nutrients to our plants. Insects and birds control most of our pests, and water readily infiltrates and is stored in our soil. Our food security improves with our gardens and farms more resilient and recovering quicker from extreme weather events, unusual pest and disease outbreaks, emerging energy and resource constraints, and global supply chain issues. This way of growing food isn't new. Around the world, traditional growers and indigenous tribes continue the use of time-honoured practices that maintain functioning ecosystems. And a small number of conventional farmers have worked out that the best way to solve their growing issues is by repairing the ecosystems in their production systems. What Wendy Seabrook and her team at Learning from Nature have done is to develop the resources to make it easier for us all to benefit from nature's free ecological services. Let's now journey to Hilltop Farm, the education centre for learning from nature, to look at examples of how they apply the five guiding principles. Ecosystems are complex, but repairing them doesn't need to be complicated. Three main functions drive most of the action in our farms and gardens: nutrient cycles, water cycles, and solar energy capture and flow. Even if we only focus on repairing one of these, we generally improve the rest. As an example, let's look at the soil. While most of our soils don't show the typical signs of soil degradation, erosion, and compaction, our soils haven't been in good working order for so long that we've largely forgotten about the free ecological services they naturally provide. We struggle to grow strong, pest and disease-resistant plants and nutrient-dense food. And when the weather turns ugly, we have trouble growing anything at all.
So at Hilltop Farm, what we're doing is we're working on getting our nutrient recycling system in our soil functioning again, because we've realised that by doing so, we can in effect give our plants, our crops, five-star catering direct from our soil ecosystem, rather than the intermittent and often inadequate fertilisers and minerals and other inputs that we apply. We're using plants and livestock to improve the supply of root tissues, root exudates, and other organic materials to feed our soil organisms. If you think about it, after all, you know, the soil organisms have been here for 3 odd billion years. So they've had all of that time to develop really good recycling facilities for the nutrients. All we just need to do is give them more resources to be able to do the job.
Notice how by growing extra vegetation, they increase the leaf surface area and consequently the capture of solar energy. With a better diet, soil organisms can also repair the rest of our soil ecosystem.
And you can see here the impact that they've had on the soil. Look at all the aggregate structure that is created by the microbes in the soil. And so in creating this good infrastructure, what we're doing is we're creating a soil so then when we do get rain, more of it infiltrates and is stored in the organic matter in our soil.
This brings us to the next ecological principle, mimicking nature. Very early on, Wendy had an opportunity to compare the soil at Hilltop Farm with soil across the road where the forest hadn't been cleared. In contrast to the farm, the soil was easy to dig, dark with organic matter, and crumbly with soil aggregates. Fast forward a few months, and Wendy found a similar dramatic difference, this time in a temperate climate in England, between an ancient woodland and an adjoining arable field.
Whenever I share this story, somebody inevitably comments, "Well, that's all well and good, but we won't feed the world growing food in ancient woodlands and forests." But that's not the point. What's relevant is that we can use the structure of the vegetation that would naturally grow on our land as, in a way, our model of best practice. We can look at how many layers of vegetation, how high the vegetation is growing, and it gives us an indication of how much plant biomass we need to grow to get our nutrient recycling systems and our soil ecosystems functioning again.
That's why Gabe Brown in the USA mimics the prairies in his part of North Dakota, and farmers in the drylands of Sahel in Africa now use useful native and other trees to mimic the open woodlands that formerly covered their landscapes. It's difficult to believe that at the beginning, the land at Hilltop Farm was so severely degraded and compacted that it was tough getting anything but weeds and grass to grow. The first bananas Wendy planted were flattened by the wind.
If I'd taken the time when I first moved here to get to know the growing conditions, I wouldn't have underestimated the extent to which the southeast trade winds that blow basically for between 6 and 9 months of the year and the heavy clay soil was going to hold me back. You can see now I've chosen plants that do really well in these conditions, and you've got the front line of the wind here. And so I've improved the growing conditions, and because we're using plants as a tool using this ecological approach, it's really important that we choose the plants that are going to give us a good helping hand.
Now the growing conditions are getting better. They are branching out into other crops like cacao, avocados and gingers, which prefer sheltered conditions and free draining soil. They're also building connections by intentionally recruiting plants, livestock and other living organisms to create beneficial relationships between their ecosystems' living and non-living parts. They use livestock to reduce the workload. The cattle and geese mow and fertilise. The chickens make and turn the compost right where it's needed.
So, I mean, one of the things I always joke about is that we've got the cattle doing all the grazing and mowing and fertilising in the paddocks, and it would be really nice to be able to find a way to use non-human biological energy to cut and drop in the bananas. That would save us a lot of energy. At the time that we're in now with the climate and environmental emergency, obviously there's a lot of pressure on farmers and other landholders to increase the biodiversity on their land. And here, we've done some plantings with natives, but even though we've concentrated on using what we call ecological support species, so legumes, his stylo, we've got lab, we've got green leaf desmodium, we've got pinto's peanut, for example. We also deep-rooted plants, biomass accumulating plants, so we're using here the bananas for food for us and our livestock, but also as a nurse crop and as a soil improver for our jackfruit and breadfruit. But it's, so even though we've concentrated on these ecological support species, and most of them are actually not native, it's incredible how much biodiversity has just come back as a result of planting all of these different things.
The farm is more resilient and able to recover when, as it often does these days, the rain comes late and waterlogs everything. One of the hardest things about growing food ecologically is switching our energy from battling against nature to co-creating with nature. But in doing so, we benefit from over 3 billion years of research and development undertaken in every climate and soil type on the planet, including our own. Now you can see why Wendy and the rest of the team at Learning from Nature are passionate about growing food ecologically.
Repairing the ecosystems in our farms and gardens isn't a quick fix. But as we start to benefit from nature's free ecological services, it becomes cheaper to grow food ecologically. And we don't need a lot of money to do it, which makes a nice change to the other things that we would like to do to help tackle the climate and environmental emergency. You know, like putting on solar panels or buying an electric car. So whatever growing practice you use, whether you're a regenerative farmer, grow food organically in your garden, or you use permaculture, ask yourself, is what I'm doing ecological? And then learn from and share your experiences with other growers. And do have a look at the resources we have available through Learning from Nature. And if you get a chance, come and visit us at Hilltop Farm.
Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video and found the information helpful, be sure to check out the resources on our website. See the links below. Together, we can reduce the costs of growing food for us and our environment.